When we think of World War I, we're hard-pressed not to think of the machine gun. And yet, even at its outbreak, many nations considered it a supplemental weapon at best. Now, Isaac Newton Lewis knew better, and would create what many consider to be the best light machine gun of the war. But was anybody going to buy it? Hi, I'm Othais, and I'm working remotely at the moment. The rest of this episode will actually be in studio. We're just doing this in the field. But I should probably say that this is the British Lewis gun, model 1914. And we'll take it over to the light box for you. With an overall length of 50.5 inches and a weight of just about 28 pounds, this is a fairly compact machine gun for World War I. Now, we did feed 303 through a drum magazine, and you had a capacity choice of 47 or 97, with that latter being more for aircraft guns. Oh, neat. I still have that same shirt, although it's kind of a little faded. We actually switched who makes these. Anyway, before we talk about the Lewis gun, we actually have to talk about a different man, Samuel Neil McLean. Born in Iowa in 1857, Samuel would lose his father at an early age. He paid his own way through Iowa State University selling books during the summers, and he graduated valedictorian in 1877 from their homeopathic department. He would establish a successful medical practice thanks to his charisma and intelligence, but by 1889, he was getting kind of bored. He was spending a lot of time at his brother's shop. Now, his brother was doing sort of like plumbing and pumps, irrigation, that sort of thing. And he had metal and tubes laying around. So the other McLean brother was starting to get into firearms. And as a matter of fact, in 1890, he would file his first patent, which was an interesting little rifle that used some sort of quadruple feed tube mechanism. With more and more ideas running through his head, McLean would set up his own arms company in 1896, aptly named the McLean Arms Company. Now, he did this with the help of friends, family, and private investors, and he would go on the road selling even more of this company through 1897, and finally in 1898, he actually submitted a rifle to trials to the U.S. Ordnance Board. This gun was an N-block-fed magazine bolt-action rifle. While this rifle is not a traditional success, it did serve to introduce McLean to one first Lieutenant Isaac Lewis, who was recording for the test at the time. Now, we will talk about Lewis in just a moment. Obviously, he's important because of the title, so cash that away. Lewis saw the first N-block loading magazine rifle. All right, now, if you look at McLean's patents, he is spreading out in all directions. Go to patents.google.com and just look for this guy. It's really interesting because he's touching on every bit of firearms that he can, looking for where he can make his dent. And three things are going to stand out. We are talking about just one for this show, but let's quickly cover the other two. The first being a recoil reducing muzzle device. This was a somewhat over-engineered muzzle brake or compensator. It directed excess gas rearward to help mitigate the recoil of a gun. It could be applied to small arms or artillery. Looking at that patent, a lot of you will probably realize that McLean was 10 to 15 years ahead of the game with that little device, and we still see remnants of it today, obviously. It just makes sense. But we're not talking about it now, except Lewis did see this device, and it may have inspired him for what we're going to see later in the episode. Now, another thing that McLean was working on that we're not getting into deep detail about was something known as the McLean gun, which was a 37mm auto-loading cannon that he was trying to market to the US and British militaries. Now, he would continuously refine and resubmit this gun basically at every step that we're going to talk about our machine gun today. So just know that that is also going on parallel, equally disappointing for him. Now, some small number were made for Russia because of the desperation of World War I, but it was never really a successful design. Moving into our third category, we are finally at shoulder arms, although we did not go straight to the machine gun. Instead, this started with the McLean automatic musket, which was actually a series of gas-operated autoloaders that McLean was constantly updating. These designs would lead to the incorporation of his company, now the McLean Arms and Ordnance Company. Big names like Marcellus Hartley of UMC and Remington Arms, and Confederate and later U.S. General Joseph E. Wheeler would join the endeavor. Despite all the enthusiasm, unfortunately, that McLean auto musket really wasn't suited for military use. Instead, McLean would hone in on a new territory using the same technology, one that sort of opened up after the U.S. adopted the .30-03 cartridge. Now, we're going to cover that in more detail on another episode. I think you guys can guess which one. But with the .30-03, the U.S. would also adopt a new machine gun. And unfortunately for the U.S., and thankfully for McLean, it was going to be the Maxim. The U.S.'s Maxim 04 was a ginormous metal box weighing in at 62 pounds alone, and another 80 were added by the tripod mount. The good news is that this left an obvious opening for a superior gun to take its place, because it was obviously not sticking around. So the McLean automatic musket was dropped, and the McLean musket machine gun emerged. This water-cooled, gas-piston-operated machine gun was fairly advanced in concept for its time. Notably, it featured an operating rod-mounted firing pin that served to cam the cylindrical bolt body into and out of lock, not unlike a Schmidt-Rubin straight-pull system. It also sported a 148-round drum magazine over the top of the action, something McLean believed he had invented first. Unfortunately, TK North had beat him, and so his company would buy the rights to use this novel ammunition feeder. Now, I am breezing through this really fast, but keep the dates in mind. This is real time going by, and the team, headed by McLean, is spending real money, and they are losing it fast on these failed submissions. The rifle went nowhere. The repeating rifle went nowhere. The McLean gun I mentioned is still in development, and it's going nowhere. They don't know it yet. They're still burning money on it. But that's what's happening, okay? So the company basically goes right down to bankruptcy and just stops. And then they pop up a second company, and then they settle a bunch of debts and blah, blah. There's a lot that you could read on the financial papers of this, but the short story is, by the skin of his teeth and by leveraging everything he owns, they kept going. And so they would be able to develop and market that McLean machine gun. From about April 1908 to December of 1909, it would be in and out of army trials repeatedly. And part of this endeavor was that they brought in the now Major Isaac Newton Lewis to take a look at what they had available to help them focus on what they should sell, which would go back to the big McLean gun and the McLean machine gun. And he said, no, there's promise here, keep at it. And that rolled in the next wave of investors, and it kind of got him just a little bit more involved in the process. But anyway, as I said, the machine gun is failing, and it's failing for some very good reasons. In trials, while firing, this gun would leak steam constantly, obscuring the vision of the firer. The magazine, loaded down with a straight helical roll, would jam repeatedly. The gas piston system would cause severe overheating, which would overheat the recoil spring and lead to a slowing rate of fire until... Alongside these failures came the unfortunate notice that the U.S. had chosen a new light machine gun in 1909. Now, McLean would receive one little reprieve in that this was the Bene Merci. We will cover this in better detail later, but the short story is, it's controversial. Regardless of the obvious opening, the McLean musket machine gun really wasn't up to the task, though. As we said, by December of 1909, it was up for its last test at the Naval Proving Grounds, and it failed miserably for the reasons mentioned above. Again. So, with that sour news, the McLean Arms companies folded. They went down hard. Everything was lost, everybody's out, and McLean walked away. But there were just a small number of investors that thought something could be salvaged. They tried selling patents and things like that, but one person wisely reached out to Major Lewis to see if he would give a final review to see if anything about this project could be salvaged. Now, Lewis would come in and look at the various guns, because we've mentioned the other models, but as pertains to the machine gun, he would say, look, water cooling's on its way out. This thing is big, inefficient, and it's not even doing the job that we don't want it to do well. I don't think there's a future for this gun. Air cooling is the next big thing. Now, who was Mr. Lewis to say this with such high expertise? The aptly named Isaac Newton Lewis was born in New Salem, Pennsylvania, October 12, 1858. His farming family would move to Kansas in 1870. Graduating from West Point in 1884 at the rank of second lieutenant, he would serve with the artillery, rising to first lieutenant. Beginning in 1892, he would work on artillery range and position finders of his own design. Many of these would be sold to the U.S. government, providing him a tidy profit. But he had wanted to sell the rights outright for one big lump sum so that the U.S. could just produce it at their own rate and sell it internationally. The suggestion was denied, and Lewis, fairly or unfairly, took it personally. He put the blame on one man, William Crozier. Born in Ohio in 1855, Crozier had also graduated West Point in 1876. He served for 3 years in the ongoing Indian Wars. Afterward, he would teach mathematics at West Point up until 1884, which means Lewis may well have identified him as a pain in the keister long before the rangefinder issue. In 1899, he would actually be included in the delegates to The Hague. Crozier would enter the Ordnance Department as a captain in 1890 and quickly rise to Brigadier General, serving as Chief of Ordnance beginning in 1901. Returning our story to Lewis, in 1898, he was assigned as a recording officer to the U.S. Board of Ordnance and Fortification. Now, this is the role he was in when he met Samuel McLean, as we said before. Anyway, around the same time, war were declared. But not World War I, this was the Spanish-American War. God, I love Roosevelt. Now, the United States won this conflict, but it's kind of odd because we had the worst toys of this game. The Spanish had the Mauser and better artillery and a number of other things, and we were still behind the times. So, it's very interesting, but even though we won handedly, the U.S. took a strong look at itself. It had been splashed with cold water, and as part of this process, Lewis would rise to the rank of captain and be stuck on a boat and sent to Europe for 2 months. In that time, he was told, confidentially, to go ahead, poke, prod, probe, and find out what we can do to clean up our artillery. In the end, he would make one solid conclusion. The fact is, we are nearly 10 years behind the other great powers, both in a proper appreciation of the need of modern weapons and the development and construction of the weapons necessary to meet this need. The Secretary of War was so impressed with Lewis's report that he would actually recommend a series of reforms and modernizations to the artillery. Now, other branches of the government would obviously get their own reports in and make their own advancements, because we are going to see a lot of changes in the U.S. after the Spanish-American War. And we'll talk more about those, especially in another episode. But, returning to Lewis, he would see another promotion, this time to major. He would be made the director of the new artillery school at Fort Monroe in 1907, and from there, he would continue to tinker. We're going to see more rangefinders, we're going to see electrical systems, and we're going to, interestingly, see torpedoes. Unfortunately for Lewis, at this time, he is going to fall under investigation, one headed by the Ordnance Board, which, at the top, was Crozier. Now, they would allege that he was profiting off of his military position unfairly, yada yada, profiteer, you get the idea. You can't be enlisted and invent things for the military and make a profit, except you legally can, it's just that people look at you funny. So, Lewis would be cleared of any charges, but it did build up that rivalry between him and Crozier once more. Alright, so we probably should get back to the McLean gun and see where we're at there. Remember, when we last left it, Lewis had said there was no real value to this in a military context. Well, a second last-ditch attempt was made to save the project by one important man, and that is Henry Willis Rudd. Now, this guy had been the international spokesman for the McLean Arms Company. He had been out in Britain trying to sell the McLean gun, obviously with no success, just like in the U.S., but he had sunk $20,000 of his own money and several years of his life into this project, and he thought it must have some promise, or if it didn't, he at least needed to hear it from the horse's mouth. So he approached Lewis, and he would actually sit down and work out just what the heck was wrong with this gun, which was technically everything. Lewis reiterated his point that this gun is too heavy, too slow to move, too dependent on a big old tripod, it can't be cooled by air, and even being cooled by water, it's inefficient at that. It's not going anywhere. I'm sorry, Rudd, you've lost your money. Well, while they're sitting there, Rudd wisely says, okay, so if the future is air-cooled, do you have any ideas about how to air-cool a gun? And Lewis, who hadn't really had an idea about it specifically at that point, had been working on an internal combustion engine for torpedoes, and part of that design, and maybe even thinking of McLean's muzzle reducer, I'm not sure, somehow it coalesced in that moment for him, and right there he sketched an idea that had come to his mind on how to move air across a barrel using a simple tube. His notion of the muzzle blast powering a cooling system stuck in his mind over the next few weeks, and he would develop an experiment. He took a Springfield Model 1903 and some various lengths and diameter tubes, one at a time. Firing through them, he'd gauge the amount of airflow generated until he had honed in on a ballpark size and placement for this device. And it worked. Lewis told his new friend Rudd about the success he had with the tests, and Rudd would rush to get other investors involved and pull some strings. They offered up one of the McLean guns and the help of an engineer by the name of Oliver Huberty. You know what? I'm bad with names, guys. It's going to be Huberty. Anyway, they offered up him to sort of help progress the idea, because you can't do it all as one man, especially if you have a real full-time job with the military. But by 1910, they had this thing kind of wrapped up and patented. Lewis had developed a simple tube that wrapped around the barrel. It projected beyond so the blast of a fired cartridge would shove the air forward. This low pressure would draw fresh air from the rear. He added an aluminum radiator so that it would draw heat away from the barrel, a heat sink. And he even went so far as to specify that the tooling mark should remain on the outside of that jacket to help with heat dissipation. It was beautifully simple and effective. Unfortunately, it still wasn't enough to cool the McLean musket. Hell, water hadn't been enough to cool the McLean musket machine gun. In order to test Lewis's jacket properly, he would need to finally fix that McLean musket, essentially redesigning it from the ground up. Rudd, the perfect American, saw another opportunity, because they would found, with the help of some more investors and the good old gang, the Automatic Arms Company of Buffalo, New York, in May of 1910. This was done to help Lewis and Huberty to get their new machine gun off the ground, and they were going to tear the McLean apart in order to get it to happen. And the first thing to go was this odd progressive drilling for the gas system. You see, we're used to one gas port in a barrel. Well, McLean thought he needed like four, and that this would progressively stack the pressure. It did the opposite. It bled gas everywhere, it lost pressure, and it added more heat. That was done away with. The overall shape of the gun was tightened up, and a single round shield placed around the gas piston and barrel. The trigger was simplified along with the cocking arm. Still, the recoil spring would overheat, so they moved it as rearward as possible, thinking initially that they had solved the problem. Honestly, it was a whole new gun, but they needed someone to manufacture it. In August of 1910, they would approach Savage Arms Company, who at the time was going head-to-head with Colt over some silly little pistol contract. Nothing we need to bother discussing, really, at all. Now, having a serviceable, light, air-cooled machine gun for military use was something Savage just couldn't resist, because that would piss off Colt real bad. And Savage loved pissing off Colt. So they would take in this new Lewis gun, and they would help modify it further until it was ready to be shown around in 1911. At this point, Lewis would need to put in some more work to really wrap up and sell this gun, so he requested a leave of absence from the military, which was sort of denied and then renegotiated into 6 months, and then it got another 6 month extension. Ultimately, retrospectively, we'll see that he gets a year off, which comes in handy because he does two things in this initial period. One, by negotiating all that time, he's put the gun in front of one major general, Wood, who will be a key player. And two, by April of 1912, he is going to solve the overheating issue once and for all. The concentric recoil spring was replaced with a gear and tooth arrangement on the underside of the gun, powered by a clock spring. This kept the spring well away from the heat of the gas cylinder and performance soared. Running down further improvements, the muzzle device was adapted just so to get that pump of air going real smooth. The drum was shortened down to 50 rounds, still in a spiral that was prone to binding, but better. We also have a two-position gas plug under the gun so that you can adjust between roughly 350 rounds to 750 rounds per minute. This is a quick change rate of fire adapter, not as good as a switch, but still adaptable and very simple. It can also be paired with setting the spring tension to get the gun dialed in just right. There are a lot of pros in this gun. I mean, ultimately, we are looking at a 25-pound-ish, light, simple machine gun. It's looking very, very promising, and they want to show it to the government. But Lewis is convinced that if they go through the ordnance department, right or wrong, that Crozier is going to stymie him, so they have to come up with another plan. He contacted the Army Chief of Staff and President of the Board of Ordnance and Fortifications, General Leonard Wood. Wood agreed to test the gun independently from the Ordnance Board and Springfield Armory. An initial informal display was conducted on May of 1912 at Fort Myer. A fair few representatives of the government turned up, including one Brigadier General Crozier. I actually don't have any notes on how the display at Fort Myer went, but within a few weeks, the Automatic Arms Company was pushing to have the gun formally tested, not through the Ordnance Board, which prompted the Ordnance Board to intervene. They said, the Army cannot test this until after we test and approve it. So you're going to need to give us one, and we're going to put it through structural tests and all this hinky-dinky before we will let anybody else look at it. Now, the Automatic Arms Company is fully behind Lewis that they believe Crozier will never give them a fair shake, so they refuse. And this leads to a stalemate up until someone new intervenes. That man would be Major General James Allen, Chief of the Signal Corps, who stepped in because he wanted a pair of Lewis guns for a little test of his. You see, he wanted to stick them on airplanes, which was practically unheard of. All he needed to do was request some 5,000 odd rounds of .30-06 ammunition from the Ordnance Department. So that fell through. Alright, at this point, Lewis is getting pissed. So he decides to take matters into his own hands and marches on down to the U.S. Army Pilot School in Maryland in 1912. He would go straight to the Commandant, unannounced, with one prototype Lewis gun and say, "Hey man, let's strap this sucker to an aeroplane." And they did. It was mounted to the passenger seat of a Type B Wright pusher, although this photo was staged a week later because there was no media handy that day. Remember, it was a surprise visit. Two 50-round drums were fired in two flights, one at 250 feet up and the other at 550. The results of this ad hoc mess were actually pretty amazing, and it caught media attention. I mean, the idea of a machine gun in the sky was crazy. So newspapers burned it up. That's why that photo was taken several days after the fact. I mean, people wanted to read about this. And so it looked like the idea was finally taking off. Of course, the Ordnance Department dismissed it as an unsanctioned test and therefore invalid. Anyway, at this point, Lewis decides he's done with the United States. He goes and joins Rudd, who's been selling the gun overseas, and they talk to the Belgians and the British. And the Belgians are smart men because they strap it to an airplane and put it back in the sky. They loved it, and soon the automatic arms company was making new business in Belgium and started looking for suitable manufacturing facilities. The British, however, they favored their Vickers for now, but they were still open to Lewis. The Flying Corps especially was curious. Now, that means that they had to find manufacturing facilities in or around Europe. Thank you. That's tricky. I mean, this is a complicated piece of machinery, and one thing that stuck out was the barrels. And so they would contact BSA in order to make them. And as part of that contact, they would bring along one of the prototypes from Savage. BSA was in love. They wanted to make this gun, and they saw where some more improvements could be made. Now, ultimately, just to speed things up, this would lead to the model of 1913, which the British would try to develop into 7 possible calipers, and they wanted to push it as wide as possible onto the world stage. Remember, this is pre-World War I. We are marketing everywhere. We're not looking at our constraints yet. So this is going to be a big seller that BSA believes it can really move. This model of 1913 featured an improved 47-round drum magazine that finally fixed that helical issue. Now, instead of a constant helix, you had 2 parallel rows with a dip at one specific spot. That kept all the cartridges from weighing down on the next cartridge below it. The gas system ranged from 300 to 800 rounds per minute, and it's still running off a closed bolt. Meanwhile, back in the U.S., in September, there was more machine gun testing going on. And as part of that, they would put up the Lewis against the Benet Mercier. Now, this was provided by the Automatic Arms Company without Lewis's previous approval, Isaac Lewis. What they did is they took one of the British 1913 models and modified it for 30-06 and submitted it to the Ordnance Board. When Lewis found out, he was furious because, obviously, that wasn't going to work. The pressures are very different, the cartridges are very different, and there had been no real time to test the Lewis in 30-06 coming from the 1913 model. Yes, they had tested the earlier ones in 30-06, but not this one. It wasn't going to go well, and it didn't. The Lewis failed miserably, and I can't even blame this one on Crozier. Luckily, BSA was there to cheer everybody up with a party, because they threw a big one in October of 1913 in order to show off their new gun, and they invited everybody. So they had tons of British officials, tons of foreign observers, tons of people from different militaries and law enforcement. They wanted everybody to see the power of this light machine gun, and it was kind of a hit. They shot it on the ground, they shot it upside down, they shot it in the air, they shot it by the pair, they shot it until red hot, they shot it even when they ought not. They shot it here, they shot it there, they shot it everywhere. Spectators were impressed. They loved it. And so orders started rolling in, so real development followed. Now, this meant that they finally had to set up a proper production line. This took time, there were little delays, so there's kind of an air gap of almost a year. This is really when things are getting honed down and governments are seeing more and more tests of these things, especially Britain and Belgium. Belgium really is paying attention. They are putting in actual orders. As a matter of fact, the first 5 Belgian guns in 765 were delivered on the same day that war were declared. The Lewis would receive its baptism of fire in August of 1914 in the hands of the Belgians. They had been provided 15 in 303 by the British. These were early pieces made as part of that test period, likely the Model 13, as we're going to talk about another model in just a moment. But the Belgians would use it in the defense of Namur and Antwerp. They would also figure out pretty quickly that these light machine guns were fairly handy for ambush and shoot and move tactics against the Germans in this delaying action that they were playing out. As a matter of fact, the Germans, hearing the odd sort of muffled sound of that barrel coming out of that tube, they would nickname it the Belgian Rattlesnake, and I don't think they appreciated it one bit. Anyway, in that same period around the start of the war, BSA has also perfected what they are calling now the Model 1914. Improvements include the reduction of the radiator diameter, rearward flipping rear sights for more, longer, better sight radius, and most importantly, it now fired from the open bolt, which aided that cooling action greatly. Open bolts, vent, heat. All right, for those of you still awake, we have now made it to our gun today, which means it's time for a union break. So I'm gonna kick this over to me from before so that I can talk to you about what this gun looks like. Now, obviously this section was filmed in advance in the field because you could see my tootsies, but that's all right. We'll get it all honeyed together for you so that you guys can see the final result. While we're looking at her, first thing I want to cover is this is a fairly early pan magazine. To release it, we'll press over on this notch and lift her out. These guys did not stay around forever. Instead, we start to see this later pattern in which we sort of reach in there and press over. Honestly, this is a lot easier on the fingers. Looking at one of these mags, by the way, we will see that we have a drum, some nice spikities, and a slot for the rim of the cartridge. So the way this is going to work, if you can see, and I gotta get a shallow angle, is there's a sort of double line fit. The tip of the bullet points inward and it rotates around. I'm not gonna get in much more detail than that because we have an animation coming up that is gonna be way cleaner than anything I can show you here. So we'll set these aside, take a look at this action. So now we can see that we are going to feed under this lip here. And I'm sorry, guys, I forgot the plastic pokey finger. So our cartridge is going to go under here. Our bullet is going to face that way, for anybody that doesn't know their orientation at the moment. When we operate the gun, you will see, and I'll have to release that bolt forward. There we go. You can see this guy, this whole armature across here. You can see him move. So back and forth. And what that's doing is positioning the cartridges for feeding. And it's also pushing them down into the bolt path. Again, much clearer in the animation, but I thought you would want to see it in action in real life. While we're up here, I should point out we have our adjustable rear sight that stays folded. You do have to pop the whole thing up in order to shoot. It's quite tall. This one has some later modification. We'll get into that in a moment. Now, we should probably talk about disassembly so that you guys can see what's going on more with the gun. So, again, fires from the open bolt, so we would be back here, and when we fire, we go forward. You can see our ribs, but like I said, disassembly. So, let me prop that with my toe for a second so that you guys can see. I'm going to release this lever forward and twist on this stock. It's a bit hard to do for the camera while huddled up in the corner, but let's see what we can get away with. There we go. Stock's free, I'm gonna set it aside. Now, we need to get further into this lock work up here. So what you can do is you can pull the trigger, pull the whole pistol grip assembly to the rear. This will have our trigger and release sear up here. It's all powered by spring up at the front. Again, it's gonna be visible in the animation. So now we can roll forward and let that bolt kind of slide back for a second. Let's pay first attention to this beautiful clock style spring in gear setup. So let me get the bolt out. So I'll pull out the handle and set this aside. Now our piston, rod, and bolt will all come out together. That bolt should look pretty familiar for anybody that's looked at a K31 before. Isn't that kind of cool? So let me set that aside for 1 second and let's look at this toothing here on the underside. So that engages on this gear here. And like we said in the history, they had to work out that concentric spring, the regular coil spring. So they went with a clock spring in this geared assembly. So when they move across each other, it puts pressure back on the spring, which is frankly fascinating. You don't see a lot of these in a lot of firearms. Again, better look in the animation. You can see that we have our permanent firing pin mounted up here. It sits through the bolt body, and it actually acts as the cam for the bolt in order to rotate it, and it's the firing pin itself poking out the face of the bolt there. Nice little compact design. Getting into the bolt body itself, we have two, count them, two extractors, so they really do make sure those cartridges come out. And you can see that we have a lug set on the top, especially tall on the top of the rear of the bolt, Now, this guy is stationary as we move. We'll see it in the animation, allowing the bolt to rotate and lock or unlock. This upper lug here actually engages on our friend here that was moving back and forth earlier. And I'll show you that here in just a second. So we got to go a little deeper into the gun. The way to do that is to remove this plate. I have a feeling with how sticky it is, I'm going to go ahead and do a time lapse on that just because it takes a little smacking. But all we're realistically going to do is make sure that this guy is all the way over, and we're going to shove that plate back this way and then pop her up. I just am going to time lapse it for you because we don't have that much time in the episode. All right. Sorry about that, guys. The plastic poundy hammer is a little bit rough on the lavalier. All I did was tap that guy rearward. And now what we're going to do is lift up. So we'll just pop up at the rear. And boom, we're in. So we can see now, we can see now this guy oscillating back and forth. We can see how there's a lug way for him to be rocked back and forth on. If we lift him out, and sorry, this takes a bit of alignment. There we go. You can see the raceway for the lug. Dun, dun, dun. All right, so we'll put him back for the moment because there's no real need to go too deep. Well, actually, you know what? I'll leave him off for 1 second. There's one other thing I can show you in here while we're in here. If I can, in fact, get something in here to lift and pull. We have a cover that's hiding our ejector. There we go. So we'll just dovetail him out. And down in here is our ejector. We can give him a poke from the other side, usually with a bullet tip, but in this case I have some pliers handy. And he will presumably come out if I don't pinch my fingers. This is riveting television for all you guys. Here, let's see. There we go. Like a game of Operation. Ta-da-da-da. So there's our ejector. You can tell he rocks back and forth. Again, this guy's going to be visible in the animation. All right. While I'm here, I want to show one other thing, though. These two guys right here, it's probably not the easiest thing in the world for you guys to see, but these are going to operate against these dimples on the outside of the pan. They're not just decorative. These actually serve to move and stop the pan. It works kind of like a revolver system, honestly. I am going to take special care in the animation to make sure that these things are clear. They're absolutely fascinating, but to me, they look like little crab mouths. All right, other than that, we're getting pretty far into the gun, so let me flip her over. Now, while I was working on... While I was working on this plate, our pin that holds the barrel assembly to the receiver assembly went ahead and worked its way free, so we have that. Normally, this is held captive by our clockwork, so I just didn't bump it out when I was going through earlier. Sorry, guys. So that pin was holding this all from rotating. Now that it's not there, we can, in fact, twist our receiver off. Dun-dun-dun. Receiver is free. That's a heck of a piece of complicated metal, but there's not much else to it now. And we'll bring this guy over and get a look at this barrel jacket. Now, I've had the bipod mounted so I could work. Time to get that out of my way. So I'm just going to free it up and press it off and give it a good yank to get it around the jacket. And she's free and clear, and I'm making a mess. So now we've got barrel... jacket, cooling fins. See where I'm at, guys? Okay, good. Another piece that was up under that bipod that is now free is our gas key. If you guys can see him now. He rests here and tabs in there. Generally, the bipod rests over him. So you can see there's a notch in the bipod to kind of sit over top of this guy to hold him in place. This allows us to have a two-position gas plug right here. So if we... adjust this, we can open up the gas port wider, keep it smaller. That helps with fouling and other things. That's just sort of a field adjustment, but we'll get it out of our way. And you can see hole and hole. So all this will set aside, and it's time to get into the shroud. For that, I'm going to need a screwdriver, which is, again, boring television. So let's do another quick time lapse. I'm just going to unscrew this screw. Okay, so now this guy's free to be... lift it out of the way. At that point, you don't have to pry him all the way off. Instead, he'll just slide down and we'll be able to remove the end of our jacket. This guy can slide off the front. We're starting to look like Buck Rogers in here, as you can tell. The rest of the gun now has to come out the other side. So I've got to drive this back towards the muzzle end. The best way to do that is to sort of hit it. So shove and smack and then pull. Oh. Sorry, folks, need a bit of leverage. Ah, there we go. All right, so big empty jacket. That's out of our way. And now you can see these beautiful, beautiful cooling fins. Look at that. That's just great. Big hunk of aluminum. And we now have our gas sleeve for the piston, so this guy can be spun off. Now, the gun could be further disassembled. We're just not in the mood for it, because what you would have to do is you would have to take a special wrench, pop this guy off. He serves as the cap. The barrel's set down in there. This is wrapped around the barrel, too. So there is actually a special tool. We have one handy, but we're not going through it. But this guy threads down over the barrel the way it would lock to the receiver, but instead it sort of overruns so that you can twist and hammer this thing out. So it's pretty good that you have a strong, strong way of doing that without tearing up the muzzle end of the barrel. But again, there's just no reason for us to press the whole barrel out of this thing just so you can see a straight piece of pipe. I think you guys get the idea. It's got a hole at this end, a hole at this end, and a little tiny hole right under there. So that's pretty much it for the teardown. If we kind of pull back, we'll see. There's a fair bit that goes into a Lewis gun. Thanks, Mae. Now let's go to Mae for more details on how this gun works. Actually, I should stop and thank our Patreon supporters, because with their help, we were able to afford a bribe to YouTube user VBBSMYT. Is there any way to pronounce that? Anyway, with his help, we can now present this beautiful piece of work on how the Lewis machine gun works. As a matter of fact, we are hoping to get his help to do all the machine gun portions for the show. Unfortunately, you guys are stuck with my usual hokey 2D stuff for when we do the rifles and pistols. Let's take a look at that cooling system. Every time we fire the gun, we're going to create a pulse of air pressure. Now that's going to draw cool air in from the rear and push that hot air out through the front. Taking a look at the gas system, we will see that with each cartridge we fire, the excess gas is going to be bled into a piston under the barrel. This drives back our piston, and our bolt. The clock spring underneath the piston returns it and the bolt forward, feeding the next round and firing it when it slams home. The bolt rotates thanks to a camway set in the bolt body, which is twisted by the straight body of the firing pin arm. Our ejector is set on the left side and works like a teeter-totter with the bolt. It smacks the cartridges out firmly to the right. Our feed mechanism is controlled by a tab on the top rear of the bolt body extension. This simply cams it over, dropping the next cartridge down. Here is our two-plane magazine with the slope just at that center point. Remember, that's important to keep pressure off the system. A pure helix adds too much weight. You can see the rods that help control the rounds and force them to feed down the slots. And now, if we look at the outer body of the magazine, we'll see a revolver-like mechanism with a pawl that's going to push it over each time. We also have a brake that prevents this from rotating the other way, essentially a cylinder stop. Speeding things up, we can now see how the gun works in concert. Returning to the history lesson, we should probably point out that the British War Office is no longer worried about just how to use the Lewis gun. Instead, they will take anything they can get, and BSA has a whole separate factory ready to make a whole new gun. Now, in honesty, the British preferred the Vickers, but at war start, they only had 109 in service. Production was ramped up dramatically, but at only 10 a week in the opening months, they weren't going to catch up soon. But as we said, BSA is ready for this, and so they would start getting orders for 5 at a time, then 15, then 30, then 100 at a time, then 400 at a time, and this would keep going, it would explode. And we're not going to go through all the critical details, but BSA would eventually build an entirely separate factory just for the Lewis gun, and they would rise to over 800 produced per week at peak during the war. That means that this was a very available gun, very important gun. But remember, up until this point, nobody's really looked at the Lewis gun as a ground infantry automatic. They really are looking at it mostly for aircraft roles and trying to figure out how an aircraft can use a machine gun and things like that. And we'll talk about that another day, but for now, we should point out that the ground Lewis did see combat. First, with those British Navy and Marine light infantry troops. These guys had armored cars with Maxim and or Lewis guns mounted. Their role was meant to be scouting for new airfields and downed pilots, but they soon became known as motor bandits for their mobile attacks. In September of 1914, one of these Lewis guns was turned on a gaggle of approaching Germans, killing some and scattering the rest. Over the next year, the British troops would have to figure out what to do with their Lewis guns. At first, it was just sort of used as a substitute Vickers, which is a terrible role for the Lewis. It's not designed for static, continuous fire above 2,000 rounds. I mean, it's not meant to be a barrel burner. And so, you would see a lot of breakages. Also, combine that with early manufacture and poorly tempered parts and things like that, you would think that the Lewis would end up with a horrible name because they would break down fairly often because they were being overused. And two, replacing those parts was nearly impossible, which breaks down into further A and B, which is that A, production is so strong that there's no spare parts to go around, and B, even when you can get those few spare parts, a lot of them were still being hand-fit at those beginning stages. Standardization hadn't locked in, and so you would spend a lot of time trying to fit the parts properly from one gun to another. So you couldn't even cannibalize two and just stitch them back together. You had to sit down with a file. But British troops were actually fairly forgiving because they seemed to inherently understand that the Lewis was being used outside of its role, that it wasn't meant to be a heavier medium machine gun. And they would start to explore just what it was good at, which is light infantry tactics. And this, a lot of this, is going to come from the Canadians. Oh man, did the Canadians know how to use a Lewis gun. Facing problems with their potato diggers, and well far back on the British ordnance priority list, Canada contracted with Savage to produce a clone of the BSA Model 1914 starting in December of 1915. Although it's not the first and only way they're going to get them. Canadian troops were some of the best combat tacticians of the Great War, and they put their Lewis guns to work double time. Instead of simply trying to run them like the Vickers and failing, they made use of the Lewis's mobility. Now, I should say that Canadians are not the only ones that use these tactics or that they invented all of them. I'm just saying Canadians are cool. Anyway, with the Lewis gun tactics, Let's get into a few of them. One, if you're using it defensively, you don't want to run it from far away, because by the time the enemy closes in, you have overheated and need to cool down, or you've locked everything up. So you want to wait and hide, and then pop it out and shoot them when they're real close. Number two, you can use a Lewis gun in conjunction with sort of high altitude bombardments of grenades and rifle grenades and little trench mortars. The idea is that when you know an enemy is in a certain area with their head down, try to pelt them with some explosives, and when they try to jump out of the way or avoid those explosives or clear that general area and they scramble up over, that's when you can pop up your Lewis guns and hose them down. A third possible choice is that you can use the Lewis gun's mobility to get into semi-forward positions, just a little bit forward, and open up with a bunch of them even, like make a lot of noise, really draw some attention. And while the enemy's machine guns or other hard points are focused on that, you can send smaller teams up and around at the edges of their vision. Like, let's say you got Lewis gun over here, Lewis gun over here, make a lot of noise. Just try to get these guys in so that these two machine guns aren't seeing it. Those guys will move in and flank from the side, clearing that enemy trench line. And if anybody tries to climb out, again, bop them with the Lewis gun. Another thing that the Canadians specifically are known for with the Lewis gun is that they did develop a lovely leather sling so that they could carry it at the hip, which provides walking fire across no man's land and makes an incredible trench broom. But realistically, who needs a sling?
Here he goes.
You good?
Yep, go. Oh my god, that was smooth.
Oh man, was that a good day. Alright, enough teasing, enough background for now. Let's go ahead and get this thing into Mae's hands so she can show you how she shoots the Lewis gun.
First things first, let's load this magazine up. This took a while, so let's speed it up. Ooh, a sunflower. Little rattle and shove. You really want to get down low, pull her in, and and again. Slower! Not bad for my first attempt, and wide open too. Let's let Othais and Jay have a go. The barn proves it's Kentucky. Okay, back to work.
Man, that really was a good day. Special thanks really needs to go out to our good friend Jeff Too, who we visited in the beautiful hills of Kentucky. That was fun. Also, Mae stole his cat. Getting back to the history, we are looking at a gun that is serving on the front line of World War I for Britain, Canada, Belgium, and possibly some others at this point, maybe France and Russia, we'll get there later. But what's the U.S. doing? I mean, it's really time that it starts considering these things. And the War Department did, in 1915, late in the year, take notice and started sifting around for ways to stack up more machine guns. And so they would go to the Ordnance Department and say, hey, can you get us one of those new 1914 Lewis guns? We want to take a closer look at it. They seem pretty exceptional. And the Ordnance Department were, unfortunately, they'd have to go over to BSA and Savage and say, hey, can one of you get us one of these guns? And both said, no, we can't. We are at maximum production capacity. Maybe we'll get to you later. And then again, in January 1916, Ordnance Department would have to come back around and say, hey, can we get one of those? And again, Savage got to say, nah, man, that's not happening. Oh, how delicious that is. But Isaac Newton Lewis was a patriot, and he did love his home country, and he did want his gun in use there regardless. So he would, on hearing all this, come home around the same time and start trying to work to have the Lewis at home. There is one thing that might have pushed this along a little further for him, and that is that his good old friend Crozier was called to testify to the Senate Committee on Military Affairs on the U.S.'s preparedness should it enter World War I. And by the end of the meetings, the senators realized that Crozier had no contingency plans for properly arming the U.S. forces, especially with regard to machine guns. Matters were made worse in March of 1916 when Pancho Villa attacked the little town of Columbus, New Mexico, and while we won't go into detail, one thing pertinent to our story stuck out. The defenders were using the Bene Mercies, which repeatedly failed, both from poor handling in the dark and general jamming. The media would declare the 1909 the Daylight Gun. Crozier predictably walked right into it. We have no gun of any kind that can be used at any time except daylight by a man who must depend on his eyesight for such operations as I have indicated. Jesus, man. Get with the times. Anyway, Lewis would go ahead and offer up a .303 and .30-06 version of his gun to the U.S. for testing. Unfortunately, that .30-06 gun stunk. I'm going to save you guys some detail work and just hit the highlights. Let's get through this real quick. In April of 1916, the .303 and .30-06 were tested by the Ordnance Board, and the .30-06 sucked. It did not work at all. In June of 1916, General Wood unofficially tested the Lewis against the Bene Mercier, a Lewis and .303, mind you, at Plattsburgh, New York. The Ordnance Department denounced that test. In July 1916, Lewis was fed up and he penned a letter to the chairman of the House Military Committee. It contained the following quote, "Our two factories are turning out nearly 900 guns a week, actually delivering each week to the English government alone more machine guns than the chief of ordnance has provided to our own service during the entire 14 years of his reign." In August of 1916, Crozier reports on the machine gun tests and declares under the Army Appropriation Act, without congressional approval, that he will purchase more Colt-made Bene Mercier and Vickers machine guns. In September of 1916, the New York Times ran an article on the front page, "The Gun Question Splits Army," which favored Lewis and blast the Ordnance Department for favoritism. Crozier would pen a response in the same, between excuses he condemned General Wood for his interference and that unofficial test from Plattsburgh. Wood would then write the Secretary of War over this matter. It was getting out of hand, so the Secretary of War put together a machine gun board headed by Brigadier General Francis French. Ultimately, this board would find favor with the Vickers, and the model of 1915 was given the final go-ahead to be made by Colt. Interestingly, at least one board member was later found to be employed by Colt at the time of the decision. Okay, is everybody caught up? Good, because in April of 1917, the U.S. would enter the war. Let's look at American preparedness. We had 3 years to sort this out, so we managed to stockpile 242 Maxim 04 heavy machine guns, 143 Colt 1895 sort of medium machine guns, We had 670 Benny Mercies, that's the 1909, and we had, believe it or not, 343 Lewis guns in 303. These were bought to serve against VIA and for testing. We also had zero Vickers. Well, the Navy at least had had enough, and so they went ahead and ordered 1,300 Lewis guns from Savage on the condition that they first pass a test, a field test. And so, 30-06 Lewis gun was sent over and immediately failed the test. 30-06 was still not working out of the Lewis gun, which was really frustrating to Huberti because he had been told that it was just fine now. And he would write to Lewis. And Lewis, who was now back, by the way, in England, he had gone back over to settle things with BSA, having seen the US stalled again. Now he's, you know, he's ping-ponging. But Lewis gets this note in the mail that's like, hey man, 30-06 isn't working. And he goes, that's weird, we fixed that problem. So he pens back to him and goes, man, we fixed that thing. We did the thing with the gas port, you remember all this stuff? And Huberti goes, no, when did that happen? And then they went, oh, let's go check the documents. Turns out BSA had never forwarded the appropriate documents for a problem with 30-06 that had already been solved. And it came down to dwell time. So what was happening is that the lower pressure 303 drove the piston back slower. And even when sped up, the pressure in the chamber still dropped faster than 30-06. So Lewis and BSA simply increased the gas port opening and lengthen that straight section of the cam slot set down in the bolt body. This increased the dwell time, allowing that high pressure 30-06 to scale down a little bit further before the breech opened. That lessened all that damage to the rod and extractor, and it stopped it from tearing cases. It solved the problem. So now we have the US model 1917 properly in 30-06. Notable differences include a left side only cocking arm, 14 radiator fins instead of 17, a simplified rear spring, integral rear sight base, and a reinforced butt cap. This version of the gun did pass inspection by the Navy, and over 4,000 were finally ordered. Now, the Board of Ordnance would come in and say, hey, we're interested, what's going on here? And test and finally approve the Lewis in 30-06. So for you Crozier haters out there, might not be entirely inaccurate. I mean, there might be some real problems with the 30-06 Lewis up until this point because they gave it the go-ahead in the middle of a war once it was absolutely perfected. Although there is an argument that they could have been more patient along the way and given better feedback instead of favoring Colt. This is a tricky thing. But anyway, we now have a US-issued 30-06 model 1917 Lewis gun ready for the front line. The Marines are being trained in it as we speak. It's all about to change the game for everybody forever. And then we run into General Pershing. He was frankly unimpressed with the Lewis and thought it was just sort of an okay automatic rifle, but thought it better to slap it on airplanes instead. He didn't really need it on the ground, I guess. As a matter of fact, Marines trained on and issued Lewis guns were going to be the first to bring that 30-06 light machine gun to the front line. But at the last moment, they were taken away and reissued show shots in 8mm and told good luck. The Lewis guns were shoved in a warehouse. What the hell? Anyway, that was it, guys. That was the closest that the U.S. Model 1917 Ground Lewis got to combat. It was pulled from then on. Thank you, Pershing, for invalidating everything we had done up until this point in the show. Anyway, that's okay. That's okay, because the Lewis was an exceptional aircraft machine gun. Which is also sad because we have not shot one, and this episode is huge already, so anyone have one of these things we can borrow? Sorry guys, but it's going to be a whole other adventure in the air. Returning to the ground models, we are going to see that the Russians were given some, we're not even sure of how many, but there were Lewis guns made in 7.62 by 54mm rimmed, and they were supplied to the Russians at some point, although likely they got lost in that whole big collapse right at that line. Anyway, they also, weirdly, were used in big numbers in Germany. They were captured and just put back to work in 303 at times, but also upwards of 10,000 were converted to 7.92 by 57mm Mauser, which means that it was a fairly well-represented gun in the German army. Now, that'll wrap up the basics of service for this gun, but luckily for you guys, we still have some more story to tie up and a little bit more drama. In their shouting match, Crozier had repeatedly accused Lewis of personal profit, and Lewis had asserted time and again that he would surrender his monetary interest in production of the Lewis for the USA. In other words, USA gets the gun, I get no monies. Well, as the checks started to clear, Lewis was true to his word. At first, he would cut back some $2,000 or something like that from the initial test batches to the government. There would be this way out about whether or not to accept the money. Crozier was potentially a little embarrassed by this, but he said, take his money, who cares? So they cashed that check. But the problem is this opened up a whole flood because Lewis kept getting checks. He would end up turning over $2.5 million back over to the government. That is not adjusted for inflation. That's $2.5 million in World War I money. That is huge, and it drew attention, and it personally embarrassed Crozier, who had spent all of this time arguing that this was a greedy man out for his own good. Oh, man. So Crozier would find himself, not just for this, but for other problems coming from the war, in front of the U.S. Senate. During questioning, he would blame Congress for lack of funding, armory workers moving to private industry, the Secretary of War himself, the entire U.S. steel industry, and assert time and again that it was no big deal that we didn't have any machine guns because the British and French were giving them to us. In the midst of all that, Lewis's complaints were drowned out from bigger names like Gatling, Winchester, Remington. They all had problems with Crozier, and they all wanted to point out that he was a firm stick in the mud, desperately holding us back from moving down the stream. They really did not like this man because he did not want to adopt anything ever. Crozier would lose credibility in December 1917. He would be forced to move away from the ordnance board and take a nominal staff position. It was a humiliation. From there, he would still dig in and deny, and even go so far as to push back. He requested a board of inquiry against Lewis while the war was still on, just because Lewis didn't like him and said so. I'm not getting with this stuff. So he would push again after the war, and he would push a third time, even after the secretary said, please don't do this, you're embarrassing yourself. At the third time, they had to give him something, so he managed to see the House Military Committee and make his case. This resulted in the secretary saying, yeah, well, the official record is exactly that you were right. We've never officially said you were wrong. So let's double down and say, yeah, you're officially correct. But what do you want me to do about Lewis? He was a civilian at that time, and I can't change his opinion of you, and I sure as heck can't change public perception of you. And that's where the matter rested, at least with the government. Crozier would still go further, and in 1920, in his own personal book, Ordnance and the World War, he would go ahead and save a fair number of pages for bashing the Lewis gun. Wrapping up with our inventor, Samuel McLean would actually retire straight to the automotive industry following those 1909 decisions, and he would return in 1919 with another gun design that he cooked up. This also did not work out. He would, in that same sort of period, start suing various financiers and gun inventors and things like that because he saw patent infringements, although his patents were also found to be based on other patents. Ultimately, it never panned out for him, and he didn't see a dime for any of this. The whole thing really depressed him, and it stuck in the back of his mind despite his other work. So that, in 1927, he was found drowning, and it is believed that it was probably a suicide attempt. His daughter certainly believed it. He would die of natural causes after a stroke, and then some piddling on for a bit in 1930. He had credited his survival to that point to the love of his daughter. Isaac Newton Lewis was awarded a Franklin Institute Medal in 1919 for his services to his country. Post-war, he would be a director for the Research Corporation of New York. He would go back into the automotive industry too, just like McLean, and file some patents, open some businesses, make a fair bit of cash there too, until he retired all of those interests in 1923 so that he could retire to New Jersey and relax. In 1931, he would be standing at a soda fountain when he suddenly collapsed and unfortunately died of natural causes before a doctor could arrive. Now, with everything wrapped up, I think it's finally time, if for those of you who are still here or have come back to watch the rest of this, to speak to Mae about her experiences with the Lewis gun. All right, we made room for Mae, but no gun. Some of you may not know this, but borrowing those things across state lines, it's a little tricky, a little expensive, requires a lot of patience, and a lot of paperwork. And plus, I don't want the government to know who I is. All right, with that in mind, though, we can still talk about the gun, and we can present some video and images to help us along. So let's go where we always do and ask Mae about the ergonomics.
Starting out with the Lewis gun, when I was first handed down at range, it was much lighter and much more compact than I was anticipating. I mean, some of those older machine guns from World War I, they have that lever system, whereas the Lewis gun, it has that piston action, so I can understand why it was that compact. It was just better than what I was anticipating when I first got out there. Now, when I'm actually handling it on the range, I did notice that cooling jacket, it is a little bit awkward, but because it's actually made of aluminum, it's fairly light, so it wasn't really muzzle heavy on range. It made it really easy for me to handle when shooting. Now, when I went to go lay it down, the bipod legs, I do want to point out, they kind of flop around. They're not super stable, so whenever you go to lay it down, any of you who happen to ever get a chance to shoot these, just make sure you lay it down and then pull it back a little bit. That really helped with stability for me. It dug those feet in, and I did not feel like it was going to move at any point. Next up, I'll probably talk about a pistol grip. The pistol grip itself, I thought, was just normal. It was fairly easy to fit in my hand. I didn't feel it was too fat or too thin, so no real complaints there. Operating the bolt was simple. It was smooth. There wasn't too much weight to it. I didn't have any problems there. But the last thing I do want to talk about is that magazine. I will say putting it on was a little bit finicky. The World War I one especially, like, I got to actually try a World War I magazine and a World War II one just to kind of have the experience between both. And there wasn't really any difference in terms of putting it on. It's still, you just got to make sure, you know, left side or right side, fit it on tight and smack it real good. If you don't fit it on just right, it's not going to seat and you're going to have to pull it off and start all over again. But when you get it on, it's nice and tight. However, when you're actually trying to use the World War I one, I will say, the little tab in there, it's kind of sharper. So I ended up, you know, nicking my thumb a little bit here or there. It's not as easy to manipulate as the World War II mag. So I did say I do prefer that one. But ergonomics wise, it was much better than what I was expecting for a machine gun from World War I.
All right, mostly good, especially when we contextualize. So let's keep digging and see what happens when we actually pull the trigger. Mae, will you break down for us firing the Lewis gun?
All right, so let's start from the very beginning. I'm lying down in prone position. I'm picking up the gun to align it. And it's at like a perfect height. That was very surprising. The bipod didn't push it up too high or too low. I was able to get a good cheek weld. So that was a very nice surprise at the beginning. And then I look down the sights. It's kind of like looking down a tunnel. I can't see anything around my peripheral vision. Then I've got that mag pan underneath, so everything down here is blocked. But right through the center, I've got a crystal clear view. So, you know, if you're on target, I can see it. Now actually firing the gun, pulling that trigger, it was kind of just like a standard Mauser trigger. It was heavy, but not, you know, super heavy. There was a lot of take up. And then when the bolt was released, there was a lot of lock time, much more than what I was anticipating. I've been used to the standard bolt actions and pistols we've shot so far. I guess I just wasn't anticipating that split second of it's going to take a moment for the bolt to go, you know, actually push the cartridge in. So that was a little bit surprising, and I can see how, like, if you're sniping, that's not really going to be something that you would want. But, you know, other than that, the recoil, when it discharged, oh my goodness. If you have not seen me actually shooting this on the episode, go back earlier and watch that, guys. Seriously, especially the slow motion, because there was practically nothing. Like, That thing weighs like about 2 Lee-Enfields. I bet if I duct tape 2 Lee-Enfields together and then fired them, there would be way more recoil than what this presented. I bet it was that piston system on it that really helped just mitigate the recoil for me, but it was fantastic. I was not expecting that. So shooting this one was a heck of a lot of fun.
Yeah, I actually got a turn, and I can agree. The Lewis is very mild. Very, very mild for 303. And part of that, again, like May said, the piston system, firing from an open bolt certainly helps. And then, in addition, we also are pushing a little air pressure out the front, too, so we're getting something like a recoil check. So it all sort of comes together along with the little bipod, which is helping as best it can, although it's not reverse-mounted like we saw in that Tiga Bear. It plays out real nice. I found it beautiful to handle. Mm-hmm. All right, so I think we need to ask a more pressing question with all these positives. Is there anything that really stands out as a strong negative for the Lewis gun?
So I have mentioned a few things along the way. The sights, basically the Lewis gun could have used an additional sight, a battle sight specifically. That would have solved that problem. Lock time was a little bit long. Putting the mag on was finicky. But I also need to mention that loading single rounds into the magazine was actually a pain in the butt too. It just took a lot of time. And I'm sure if you go back and you've seen it on the video, it took much more time than what really was necessary, in my opinion. But there was one big flaw that happened on range that I thought was not great at all. It actually double fed, like at one point. Well, technically triple fed. We had 3 rounds that got locked in the gun at one time. So we took the mag off, and the problem is you can't really back up the system. So we had to clear the rounds from the ejection port. And when you realize and think about it for a second, the Lewis gun, it's basically going to be like a slam fire. So if that bolt travels forward, it's going to discharge that round. So it was a little disconcerting to have to clear the rounds through the ejection port. But, you know, that was a huge flaw in my opinion. Other than that, the other things were kind of tiny and I could deal with. But yeah, that was a pretty big flaw.
Yeah, for all the ammo we burned on range for a 100-year-old gun, honestly, the Lewis has probably performed better than many of the bolt actions we've seen. We had exactly one jam, and it was exactly one major pain in the butt. Because, like May said, you have one round that failed to fire in the chamber. So the gun, or not failed to fire, but rather fails to eject completely. It slips the extractor, so it gets stuck, right? So the gun pops back just enough to pick up the next round, which gets slammed right next to the first one's primer, which doesn't really matter at that point anyway. But at the same time, the feed mechanism pulls in a third round just past the feed spring, and it's locked in. So you can pop the mag, but you can't really back everything off. So you have to sit there and fish everything out through the ejection port, and you don't really have the convenience of certain lock opens and things like that. It was a pain. It's the price you pay for a system that is so incredibly simple, though, and I imagine that people who have more experience with the system would be able to handle it a lot faster. So it's not a system killer, it's just a slight disappointment. So now that we've sort of talked about the less admirable aspects, we still have to kind of say it's World War One. You must select from the World War One machine guns. We can't just magically invent ones that weren't there. Do you take this one into battle?
So would I take this into battle? Let's think about when the Lewis gun was released into the war. It was at the very beginning. My options for light machine guns at that time were the Lewis gun, the Shoshaw, and the Ben Air Massey. The Lewis gun destroys them. So yes, I'm going to take the Lewis gun into the battle. Don't get me wrong, there are other ones released later on, like the BR in the war, that I might prefer over this. But for now, for the time, for what I've got available, I'm going to go with the Lewis. It did have that one misfeed during the shoot, but that was just one problem. It still functioned really well. I was deadly accurate with it. The cartridge is all right. I'm going to go with the Lewis, and yeah, I would take it.
All right, well, I guess that wraps it up with an overall positive review. Remember, light machine gun technology is very new in World War One, so there are limitations. Well, with that, let's go ahead and wrap this out to the credits. Updates afterwards. I know you guys have been waiting around for a long time, so for those of you who made it this far, I thank you for your patience.
Thanks, everyone.
Alright, I might be a little discombobulated. I've been editing for 14 hours. I know of at least 3 mistakes in the episode that I am not going to fix because it is past midnight on Monday and I still have to render this. Anyway, I want to very specifically thank Jeff 2 again. This is one of 3 things that he helped us out with. The other one was the Tigaver, and the next one I think you could probably guess at this point. But we need to then thank our Patreon supporters, because that was the only way we were getting this done. That and some Indiegogo posters and t-shirts and things like that really went a long way to making sure that we had the funds available to go to Kentucky, film all of this in a frenzy, get back here, and then sit on it for months and months because I didn't have the time because I was making other episodes. But the reason this managed to roll out is because we had enough funds to help support an animator who's going to back us up on the machine guns. Now, these take like 2 months to make, so he's not going to be doing the regular episodes, but it's not enough when somebody takes 2 months to do something to just say, please do it for me. You got to be able to give them something, and we're not giving him what he really deserves yet. So by all means, if you are enjoying the show, we have roughly 8,000-9,000 people that are watching within the first 24 hours to 48 hours. If every one of those people that were tuning in regular gave $1 a month, we would be set. We'd be golden, and there'd be a lot more content like this because I could make sweeping, quick decisions and get more help in here. All right, now moving down to other announcements, I had an email from a viewer by the name of Jamie. Now, he would like everybody to know that they have a wonderful World War I reenactment going on, and that is set in April and in November. The link is down in the description. Unfortunately, we can't make the November this year. It's just too short notice, but I'm actually trying to figure out if we can make the April. It depends on the production schedule. And then finally, do not forget that we do have a voice channel set up for video gameplay, like the Verdun game you're seeing now. And for those of you who are going to ask me about BF1, I did not have time to play the beta. We were slammed, but I've heard a lot of things. All right, talk to you guys later. Bye.